In my talk, actually, by thanking Paul Peters. Paul was our conference chair last year, and it was a fantastic conference, I have to say, last year. It was really energetic, and there were some really exciting discussions going on. And Paul took on the task again this year of organizing this conference, and I'm sure it's going to be equally as successful. And I also want to thank some of the other staff from Hindawi who have been here and helped prepare various things for us and are working the registration booth, and Mohammed in particular, who, there you are. Thanks. Okay. Let me see if I can pull up my presentation here. There we go. So as Paul said, I have been working with OWASPA, but I also, alongside that, am one of the co-founders of CoAction Publishing, which is a small but growing, we like to say, publishing house based in Scandinavia. And the three of us that founded it, we earlier had worked in Taylor & Francis Informa before we decided to move into open access publishing. And today, before I get into my topic, I too would like to thank the sponsors because it does help make things possible. And you did such a good job. I was going to say a lot more about it, but we'll just say really thank all of their support to help us make this happen. And thank you to all of you for coming today. We have such a diverse group, and that's really exciting to see. So I was going to be talking today about open access publishing and retaining the core, stimulating progress. Some of you, this might be ringing a slight bell of putting that concept together, and that might be if you've read this book, Built to Last. You may have also read the other book that the authors wrote called From Good to Great. And this is by no means a new book. I think it was first published in the mid-1990s, but I happened to be rereading it earlier this summer. And there were a couple of concepts in this book that really jumped out at me as saying a bit about where we have been with open access publishing and the discussions about open access publishing, and a little bit as well about what our next challenge is and where we're moving into. And the first concept, I'm just going to pull out my notes here. Actually, I should probably go back for those of you who haven't read this book and just say what it's about, actually. What Collins and Porras do is they conduct an ethnographic and very in-depth qualitative study of what they call visionary companies. And they define that, among other things, as companies, organizations, let's say, because I know some of you represent other types of things that aren't necessarily companies, but organizations that have, among other things, been around for at least 50 years, who are recognized in their sector as being one of the leading organizations. And what they then did was take a look at all of those and then contrasted them as well with other companies that have not been quite so visionary and that don't meet their criteria to try and see what is it about these companies that's in common. So what are the success factors, the success criteria in order to be built to last, to be there for the long term and to continue to be successful? And one of the first concepts that I thought was interesting, there's just two I'm going to mainly look at, but the first was this. They say it's very human nature that we get caught up in what they call the tyranny of the or, that we tend to think very often in the world as either or choices, so that if I'm going to have dessert tonight, I can have cake or ice cream, right? But what is really in common to these visionary organizations is that they don't get stuck in the tyranny of the or, that they actually embrace the genius of the and, as Collins and Porras talk about. So they don't see the world in black and white, but as we're just going to create it. And just to give you an idea of what that means, they say we tend, these are typical things in organizations and particularly companies, and I think even if you're not a for-profit, you'll recognize some of these, that you can have change or you can have stability. You can be conservative or you can be bold. You can have low cost or high quality. You can create wealth for your shareholders or you can do good for the world. You can be idealistic, so you can be driven by values, or you can be driven by profit, pragmatic. You can invest for the future, or you can do well in the short run. So the companies that weren't so visionary tended to get stuck here, whereas visionary organizations embrace and. So they say we can have change and stability. I'm going to come back to that point. We can be conservative, but we can be bold at the same time. You can have low cost and high quality. I'm sure Hindawi would agree with me there. You can create wealth for shareholders, but you can still do good for the world. You can be idealistic, but you can still be pragmatic, and you can still make sure that there's a profit if you need that. You can invest for the future, and you can do well in the short term. And when I read this, it really occurred to me, this kind of jumped out, that really, for many years, I think the discussions and the discourse around open access publishing, we were kind of bogged down in the tyranny of or. Open access publishers themselves were embracing this and saying, we know that we can have and. But there was a lot of or thinking nonetheless that was going on. So some of these you might recognize. I tried to pull some of them out. That you could have open access or quality. You could have open access or impact. You can have open access or prestige. Open access or peer review has been a really big one. I mean, I just recently was at an exhibition, and still, I think we've come past this quite a bit, but still someone said, oh, so it's not peer reviewed. And I felt myself going into that dialogue again that no, it is, and these things. Fortunately, we're really coming far in proving that, and this is what I want to say, is I think we're really moving beyond the tyranny of the or, and we really are embracing the and. Clearly today, we have open access journals that are showing that they're high quality. We have examples of open access and impact. I'm jumping into my next thing here. Some of the other ORs that we've seen is that open access publications or repositories, that still gets kind of discussed and debated. Open access or you're honest. Okay, that one keeps popping up. And this too, I think, is relevant for many of you who are joining us today, that you can have open access or toll access, or that you can have open access or financial stability. But as I say, I think that we're really embracing the and. We're showing that we have open access journals that are also quality. We have open access journals that also have impact. Even PLOS ONE, who had to fight for years in order to get an impact factor, and now when they finally did, it's over four. So we know today that these can go hand in hand. Open access and prestige. There are many open access journals today and open access publishers that are now building up a prestigious reputation. And we all know that open access and peer review also go hand in hand. And I think one of the things that really tells me that we're moving beyond the tyranny of the or is the fact that we have the group that we have joining us at this conference. We have on our guest list today not just open access publishers, the usual suspects of PLOS, Hindawi, BMC, and the rest of us, but also Springer. We have Elsevier here. We have Wiley-Blackwell, OUP, IUP, a number of publishers. And I think, if we're really honest with ourselves, 3 years ago, that probably would have been almost unthinkable. Some of you may be even having identity crisis right now because you're sitting in a room as an open access publishing organization. So I hope that part of my talk today will sort of relieve your fears, because I think that you're now embracing the and. You might be doing that willingly. You might be doing it unwillingly because the powers above you are pushing this on you. You might be doing it actually valiantly because maybe you're the only one in your organization that really wants to embrace and right now. But I hope we can give you some things in this conference that you can take back. And again, I think the other, that we can have open access and toll access within the same organization, that at the current juncture, one doesn't necessarily have to choose. The second concept that Collins and Peross take a look at with these visionary organizations, and one that I think says a lot about our next challenge now. We're moving beyond the tyranny of or. It's still there to certain degrees in different fields, but I think we're really resolving a lot of that. But this says a lot now about where we're going. The visionary organizations that Collins and Peross took a look at did a great job of preserving the core and yet stimulating progress. So on the one hand, they were extremely conservative because they had this core idea about this is who we are, this is what we do, this is what we're about. This is our core ideology, our core set of values. But at the same time, they had a whole lot of progress going on in the things that they were actually doing and among their product lines. And what they say, in order to do that though, to keep this progress going, you of course have to differentiate between core values and what are non-core practices. Because you need to know what is it that we're going to be extremely conservative about and hold on to, and what is it that we can be radical and radically change. Now, what does that have to do with open access publishing? Well, when I read that, it really occurred to me, open access publishers share the same core value as other scholarly publishers, but we are reshaping and driving change along non-core practices. So I hope that if you were having an identity crisis by joining us today, that maybe this can give you some comfort that we do share the same values. But why has it been so controversial then earlier? And I think it's this. The authors also point out the fact that non-core practices tend to be confused with core values. We tend to confuse those things sometimes. And they have some examples of organizations that, in fact, started holding on to non-core things and changing the core, and who are no longer with us today as a result. And of course, that then follows that if we confuse those things, then that can lead to some critique, it can lead to some concern, because there may be this misunderstanding that by changing practices that are in fact non-core, that we're actually changing the core, we're changing the core values about what we're about and what we're doing. And so, I again want to say we share the same values. So maybe what's really important and what's interesting, and I think is very much a topic at this conference, is we're going to be going ahead and talking a lot over the next few days about practices, about establishing best practices, things that are working, what we can share with one another. But I think we maybe want to take a step back first and also think about what values are there, because we can have and change lots of things on the non-core as long as we're all making sure that those things support the core in the best possible way. So I've tried to give some thought to what would be some of the values that we share together as scholarly publishers. And you may agree, disagree, I hope you agree with these. And the first is quality control. We all, I think, agree that there is something different about a scholarly text in comparison to any other text we might read. It's not the same as a journalistic article, right? And that's because we need to make sure that there's evidence of scientific rigor on that paper. We want to know that there's a valid and reliable methodology that's underlying it, that it's grounded theoretically, that the empirical material that's presented is sound, and that the argument that's made makes sense in relationship to that evidence. It makes an independent contribution to the field. And some of the ways that we do this today, our practices, of course, are in peer review and blind, double-blind, and we make sure there's editorial control and editorial boards. But actually, those are sort of non-core practices. So there's a lot of changes in experimentation going on today, and it's not in an effort to change this core value of having quality control, but to take a look at ways, different ways we might be doing that. I think a second value that we all agree upon is integrity. And of course, integrity as publishers, but also integrity of the article itself. So we always want to make sure there's no plagiarism involved, that it is authentic, that those people who have written the article actually did write the article, that there aren't commercial interests that have been running what's been presented here, and at least there's no unstated conflicts of interest, and preferably no conflicts of interest, of course. That editorial decisions are objective, that authors listed have made a contribution. And some of the ways that we've been doing that were copyright in order to protect sort of the author. And now we're using licensing. In particular, OWASPA supports Creative Commons licensing. So there's some other ways that we might be protecting this. Also things like cross-check from Crossref. We have a lot of new practices coming up that can help us to support this core value of integrity. We also all agree, I think, that knowledge is cumulative, right? So you can't have a research paper that doesn't refer to anyone else. That's just a diary entry. So we use reference lists, we use citations, and this also leads, of course, to an interest in impact. And we count citations, we have an impact factor, and we use various metrics. But I mean, having an impact factor and the way in which we calculate it today, it's not a core value. It's a non-core practice that we use in order to support a core value. I think sometimes in a lot of circles and at universities, that impact factor has almost become confused with a core value. But there's other ways that we could be measuring these things. And of course, it means distribution is important. And we, because if you don't read it, you can't cite anybody. And we've done this with paper. Some people are still doing it on paper. Some people are all electronic. Some are both. And now, of course, we're having to also have apps. So how we're going to distribute that as well is going to be changing. Subscription, licensing, open access, all of these things, of course, are non-core practices, but we do them in an attempt to support the core. And I think two other practices that are coming that are, of course, very interesting are data mining, new search models such as IHOP, which is this information hyperlinked over proteins, which some might be familiar with. You kind of basically get a database where you can key in a protein and get up, this is the state of knowledge about that protein today. Jan Veltrup last year presented nanopublications and triplets. I think I'm starting to understand that, but I think these are other new practices that are also coming along. So we do actually have a lot of radical change along the core. The other thing, of course, is that the scholarly record is a permanent record. And we as open access publishers also support this. Everything we publish has to be around for posterity. So we use archiving. We've used archiving on paper earlier. We're moving electronic. We've got national, international archives, et cetera, et cetera. And the other thing, of course, is that it's very important that nothing be removed from the scientific record. We earlier had, during the year, there was evidence, there was a paper that was published, and then we saw that that publisher happened to remove it because there had been some criticism of it. And, for example, WASPA took initiative at that point to contact that publisher and say, we happen to notice this, and we, in case you didn't know this from before, it's really important that we then instead publish an addendum and let us know that that's been retracted and that remove it, right? And then prestige. And I put this in brackets because in some way, maybe not everyone wants to admit it, but of course you publish for prestige, and we of course want to have prestigious journals and prestigious people publishing in them. I'm not sure, is it a core value, is it not? But I think it's in there. And of course this leads to a lot of non-core practices that are changing in various ways in terms of indexing and ranking. We like to publish our rejection rates because that shows how prestigious we are. We have editorial boards and we like to have good names on those boards and impact factors, and I'm sure you could add to this. And so I think, just to repeat that, that we share these core values. And you know, the name of this book, Built to Last, I think if there's something that's been built to last, it's been scholarly communications. Because while they took a look at companies that were at least 50 years old, and some were 150, but we're all involved in an enterprise that is not 50 years old. It's not 100 years old, but it's actually centuries old. And so there must be some core there. And I think at least these things are some of that core, and you might add some other things to it. And probably your organizations have core values that even further build and support on that. And just to mention some other non-core practices, we have journals today with or without issues. This is not entirely unproblematic. We at Coaction Publishing recently got some of our journals in Thomson Reuters, and they came back and said, well, we need to have issues. And we said, but we don't have issues, but you have to have issues. And we said, no, we know, and fortunately we knew, that you're indexing BMC journals, you're indexing PLOS journals, you're indexing Handawi journals, and I know they don't have issues. Oh yeah, but I know that it took a bit of time for people to understand that that didn't mean that we weren't serious, it's just that we're changing, we don't have to have issues, it doesn't detract from the core. And of course, not numbering, I meant pagination here. I think I did a little Norwegian slip in here. You know, we've also encountered this sometimes as being problematic to understand that we don't paginate a volume from start to finish, but we just paginate within the article because many of us use DOI numbers now, and this has also been some indexing services and some databases are still having a bit of a difficulty with that. And it doesn't mean, again, that we're changing the key elements, we're just changing the practices around them. And of course, selling subscriptions and licensing, engaging in all of these other ways that we charge or don't charge for what we're doing is also, of course, a non-core practice that we can make changes in and that we need to discuss from time to time. And dare I say it, but I also think what we publish and understand as a journal or a book today is also probably a non-core practice. We're engaged in scholarly communications, and we will continue to be engaged in scholarly communications, but perhaps the form that that takes as a book or a journal may be changing. And I know that Ilko is going to be talking about books, for example, and some of the challenges there, because the book is certainly changing shape. But also, if I just am allowed to bring up PLOS One as an example, I know that in talking to Mark, I mean, there was a lot of confusion. Is it a journal? Because it basically, you can publish anything on science in here, right? And that part, of course, fueled a misunderstanding about, is this changing our core? because it doesn't fit into the frameworks that otherwise have been established in terms of practices. So I know that PLOS had to fight a bit of a battle to get an impact factor for this journal, and it still doesn't really fit into any of the categories in Thomson Reuters. So I think that this format is really changing. And of course, your PLOS Currents is also, I think, another example of how it's also changing in another direction of communicating, but at a different level, and that it's not taking the standard format of an article as the basis. I also brought up Hindawi's scholarly research exchange, because I think this goes to the quality, but I think it's really interesting and perhaps even slightly radical change on a non-core practice again, because as I understand this and having listened to Paul describe it, number one, you go to this site and you can choose a number of areas that you could publish on. So it's not one journal in the sense of being one journal with one topic, but having a number of topics. And that peer review does take place, but rather than being an editor-in-chief that then makes the ultimate decision that it's published or not, it's actually the author, him or herself, that chooses. Because the reviews come back and they're going to be visible to the public, and you've gotten ratings from each reviewer from 1 to 5 stars, and then based on what they've said about you, you yourself have to decide, do I want to now enter this into the permanent scholarly record or not, or do I want to do some more work on it? So I know that Hindawi is not trying to change quality. That's still important. There's still peer review and mechanisms attached to this in order to do that, but there's a transparency that lets us then judge this quality in a different way. So why did I want to bring all this up? I don't want to lecture you on having core values in your organizations necessarily, but I think it says a bit about as we move forward over the next few days, we're going to be talking a lot about practices. We're going to be looking at how we're financing open access, what types of models we can have there, what should books, open access books, look like, what are they, how can we judge quality and all of these core values for those journals, or books, I'm sorry. And a number of other issues. And though we have core values, and though we should encourage lots of different kinds of practices in order to discover good practices that help us sustain the core in the best possible ways, I think we still need to, from those practices, pull out standards, and we need best practices. Because we're not talking, in this case, at an organization level, but we're looking at the next level, sort of meta level. And in order for the people that we serve to understand what we're providing, it can be useful for them to have some standards that we've taken a look at the practices out there and said, these are the practices that we feel do support that core and that are going to do it in the best possible way as we move forward. So I think in the discussions we want, particularly in the breakout groups, we are looking from a WASPA's perspective, for you to provide us what you think should be some of the best practices, the things that we should encourage as standards, so that we can then disseminate that back out to others. I also think it would be very useful for us, because there is still some concern about, are we changing the core? People don't say it in those terms, of course, but we, you know, there's things that, this question of, is it honest, are open access publishers honest or not, et cetera, et cetera. I think, again, that comes from that fear that as we change practices, we're changing something that's fundamental about scholarly communications. And so I think it could be very useful for us to explicitly define our practices and link those back to the core values so that we can show people this is how these things work together. Some of you have applied for a WASPA membership, and you probably expected that it would be like any other organization, that you got a letter back saying, great, welcome, please pay this amount of money, you're in. But what normally happens is you get a letter back that says, thank you for your application. There's some things we'd like to talk to you about. There's things we noticed on your website. We noticed that you're not using a licensing agreement. There's almost always something that we'd like to ask about. And that's because we have recognized that there is value right now in being very explicit in defining our practices, and particularly, for example, peer review. We look that there's a very, very explicitly stated peer review policy and how that happens. It's not good enough to just say it's blind, double blind, but we want to know how does that operate in practice. I was talking about that already. And so For those of you who weren't at this conference last year, this was a very energetic conference. It was a very friendly conference. We had a lot of fun, but we also got a lot of work done in terms of thinking about where we want to be going, things we want to be moving forward. And so I think that this is going to continue, because one of the things that I have really found in working on the OWASPA board and with open access publishers is these are people that I'm embracing, and not just in their businesses, but sort of generally, because these were people that in many cases jumped into open access publishing when there was absolutely no guarantee that this was going to work and that we would find a way out. But it's people who say, okay, we think this would be interesting, so how do we work this out? And I think there's a sense of that spirit here of you can sort of be open and say, I'm thinking about this, here's an issue, how could we fix that? So I really look forward to this conference carrying on that energetic spirit that we had last year. And I want to leave you with this thought that please be very conservative over the next 3 days, but embrace change and come up with some great and radical ideas and things we haven't thought about before and challenge us to take a look at how we can move forward in all of these areas. Thank you.
Okay, we've got quite a bit of time for questions, so does anyone want to start us off?
So my name is Mark Patterson. I'm from the Public Library of Science. I thought it was a really, really nice talk. I really thought it was a great framework to look at things as core values and non-core practices and stuff, and I really enjoyed that, lots of food for thought. I just want to make one clarification, because I think it's important. You said that we fought with ISI.
Not be a nice way to say it.
Well,
Thank you.
There was some very rigorous discussion with ISI about why on earth they weren't indexing PLOS One, and that was the issue for us. It wasn't. We don't want an impact factor for PLOS One, because the whole point of PLOS One is it's antithetical to the idea of impact factors, because what we're trying to do, the non-core practice that we're trying to change in PLOS One, is this idea that you have to judge work on the basis of how important it is before it's published. And that's the thing that PLOS One challenges. The peer review process in PLOS One focuses, you know, as you said, purely on whether it's rigorous or not. However, it was really irritating that they wouldn't index it, and because indexing in the Web of Science means something as well. It's not just about getting an impact factor. So so I just wanted to make that distinction. It was important to our authors that we were indexed in Web of Science. We certainly didn't, you know, it's just one of these things. You know, we didn't want an impact factor, but if you're indexed in the Web of Science, that's what you come with. Mm. An impact factor for PLOS One is essentially meaningless, as it is for most journals.
Okay. There was one of the first of the radical ideas to come out of the conference.
Anyone else?
Bukri Stabjörk from Hanken School of Economics. I just wanted to comment, because I've been publishing, I've been editor of an open access journal since 1995. I've published a lot of articles, but we submitted an article to PLOS One in early May this year. It was published late June, and in fact, the decisive factor to go for PLOS One was we saw this notice on your board sometime earlier in spring that you're going to get an impact factor. And this has not to do with my thinking about open access such, but the fact that in our own university system, it's such an important thing for a subject to get papers into ISI journals with impact factors. And when authors choose journals using this criterion, they're behaving perfectly rationally, because it might be the decisive factor for somebody junior to get tenure or to get grants from the Academy of Finland and so forth. So it's unfortunately a fact of life for academics. Of course, yeah, I have challenged it over the years many times, but for this particular article, I'm just telling you as evidence that this was a decisive factor why we chose to submit to PLOS One.
That's kind of the irony as well, since PLOS journals are now highly ranked, but yet, as you say, it's not something necessarily that you're concerned about at PLOS. The actual impact factor itself. Mm.
Anybody else?
And it's a barrier for all open access as well.
Yeah. That's right. And I think Peter Suber gave the keynote address at last year's CoAusp, and he noted the sort of key challenges that open access journals are still working to overcome. And one of those was what he called measuring up. Since we currently value things on the basis of that impact factor, as I say, I truly think it's almost been confused with a core value today, that what happens is because open access journals are very often new journals, that we're discriminated against that, and that we probably should be looking to see, are there other types of metrics that we could be using to replace those? And I looked back at his talk, and I saw that you see that it's actually creating that tyranny of the or, because now you're getting this, you can publish open access or get impact. And in fact, there was a journalist in a Swedish newspaper that recently wrote an editorial, not that recently, during this past year, and she was writing about open access. And then she went out and asked professors at Karolinska, leading medical professors, would you publish in an open access journal or one with prestige and impact? And the interesting thing was they didn't even react to the question being structured as such. It's so assumed that you have the or. And so, of course, what did they answer? They answered that they would publish in a journal with impact. Now, what's interesting, of course, was that if you Google these guys' names, they're actually on the boards of open access journals. And heaven forbid, you know what? They've even published in PLOS Medicine. And so, I mean, these guys didn't even sort of see it in there. So, I mean, we really, that one's, I think, going to be one of the toughest ones for us to tackle and really move beyond.
We must have some more questions. We've got lots of time, so.
So someone asked me when I was talking about this earlier why I didn't put anything about money in there. And one could say, are librarians today trying to push in a new value that would be sort of affordability as a value? One of the things, though, that I thought was quite interesting in this book, if you read it, is that they noticed that among the visionary organizations, in their sort of core mission and values and their statements about themselves, they didn't mention profit, that their goal. And they sort of summarized it as that everything takes, of course, resources and things to make happen. But in the same way that the body needs food and air, we don't live to eat and breathe. And so that those are the kind of things that are there fixing that, which was why I decided not to take that in as a value at this time, because I also think that approach is probably at the organizational level as well, because I know sitting here today are for-profit, non-profit, societies, scholar publishers doing this on their own initiatives.
Okay, well, if there's no more questions, then please help me in thanking Caroline.
Thank you.